Li olumi abaliti yeteveraki senebeti. Olumi lijahi wadasi huchi. Simule mizigini yamekebawe nyowe. Blessed Sabbath to all members. All praises to Jah. His name is worthy to be praised. Ulumi ikerisi tosi abaliti salami ali selasi. Wizuhi Yehuda and Basi. Wizuhi Exebia Begi Molati Nui. All members of Christ, Eli Selassie, is the Lion of Judah, is the fullness of the Lamb of God. Moa and Basi Ziem Negedi Yehuda. Lion of Judah has conquered. Be Exebia, let it be that you hulu, Tina Yestilin, Exebia Yemis. To all beloved of God, a blessed day. May God give you health. Praise be to God. When I give a prayer to all and for all sons and daughters of my Father, because in Iowa we worship and we must worship in reverence. We reason, we must reason reverence. We give praise in reverence. Jah! Rastafari. A prayer for all the lights. And then that's the Rastafari. Holy Yuli, Yexebia, Kekefu, Adeni, Trebaki, Unihina, Dehini Haini Tini, Ti Ebeki Hini, Ekuli Kenhi, Lilati Hena Kinheni, Kimarami Dihuvi, Chene Favre, Tehebeki Hini, Bezemi. Habi we ready, we Memphisi Kedusi. Simi lezili, alimi, ina lezili, alemi, ahuda hamlak. Anidi amilaki, kedisti selasi. Amen. O Most High God, deliver me from all evil, be my protectorate, and keep me safe. O protect me from the pestilence that walks at noon. Night and day, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever. One God, one Holy Spirit. I repeat. O Most High God, deliver me from evil. Be my protectorate and keep me safe. O protect me from the pestilence that walk at noon, night and day. I pray in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. One God. Blessed are the children of my Father. Bless all sons and daughters of Exebia. Bless them that bless themselves in Rastafari. Bless them that bless themselves in Haile Selassie, Qedamawi. Exebia, Yemisken. Exebia, Kuta Yinisi. Blessed be thy name, O Most High God, Exebia. Blessed be thy name. We forward in this topic, and then we reason, for we shall reason about the Sabbath and interference of Rome, the hand of fever, who feed the Ethiopian, who disregard the truth of the Sabbath with the bread of fever, let fire burn them soul, fire upon Rome. Thy name, O Most High God, thy name. Blessed love, all ones and ones. Blessed love, all children of the Most High God, Exilia. Blessed all them that follow the Christ Lamb, and all them that accepted the Christ King, Qedamawi, Haile Selassie. I hereby do this video under the fullness of an error done and sent by many who claim themselves victor, being victorious against the Christ King. I reason with a brethren named Jonah Sife. He reason as if he is an Ethiopian, doubtless not an Ethiopian, I understand that he's a German. I reason with the brethren, and I understand the fullness of his thought against Rastafari, them that follow the fullness, them that accepted Haile Selassie as King of Kings, their beloved Lord. I understand that he was a Rastafarian, not was a Rastafarian, because no one can be was. Rastafarian is a born Rastafari, one that follows his majesty and the fullness of his prophecy endorsed by King David, and the one that followed the concept of Haile Selassie, the Christ King, is one that born. It's an inborn concept. It's not a selected concept by the man, by anyone. It's a born inward concept. Therefore, Rastafari, anyone that follows the concept of such, is forever Rastafari. But this brethren claimed to be of the fold at some time. But then, I understand that he refrained from the fullness. And so doing, he set himself and handle of a weapon against all brethren and sisters that follow the fullness. He also delighted himself as one who preached against the gospel of Rastafari. And he claimed to hold a mantle, claiming to gain souls for his own fullness and understanding against Rastafari. We reason upon the fullness of the Sabbath, and this brethren encloses his thought reasoning to the fullness that he endorses the fullness of a Sunday Sabbath. He claimed also to enlighten an understanding that his majesty also endorses the Sunday Sabbath. But I ask a question, which Sabbath or Sunday Sabbath is he referring to? Because his majesty at no time had refrained from observing the first Sabbath, the seventh day Sabbath, given to I and I through the fullness of the Christ Lamb, Jesus Christus. I say the fullness of the Christ Lamb, Jesus Christus, because it's a new covenant given through him. Reverence through his blood, the blood of the Lamb of God. We will hang upon it no law. No law of the scribes and Pharisees, but the law of Jesus Christus, the law of faith and truth. Sabbath with dignity and its own self of perfection. Sabbath before man. I didn't ask a question. And I therefore not even ask a question. Because fire burned the souls of them that swapped the Sabbath of the first Sabbath to the Sunday Sabbath. Fire burned their soul. Fire burned their soul. Naturally, and I speak with affirmation and great strength. Ye Exebia, Yalahuninwini, Ulu Izati, Yakati Lali, fire burn all that is called. Rastafari. Blessed be him, Qedamawi Haile Selassie. Blessed be his name forevermore. Now I ask a question. Tell me why millions of Ethiopians would have to die for the first Sabbath? A human talk straight. They died because the king of Ethiopia, Emperor Susanius, bowed to Rome. The liturgy, clergy, and elders of the Orthodox faith swallowed the evil bread of death that was shared to all heads of the church. Fire burned Rome, and that is prophetically speaking. Here he for ready. Yiji Hemery, Izati, Yakatinani, Yakatilal, Yakatili hina yumli yija abidiwilu. Li hulu ulumi abalite yeti baraki seneti beti. Ulumi li jahai vidasa uchi. Let the judgment commence. Let fire burn Vatican and all corners of Jah. Blessed Sabbath to all members. All praise to Jah. The wiggy tattoo, ye Xavier, Yalehuni, Babyloni, Romini, right licky one happy, Papa Satini, Sereti, Amelikun, Chini, Ina, Kesiwi Sitini, B. Izatiak Atilali, Veji Freddy, Yiji Mary, Silla, Fire Burn, Babylon, Rome, Pope, Liturgy, Clergy, whose act is not of Jah, let Jah judgment begin. Sila. I reason on the fullness of the Ethiopian Sabbath. Ethiopian Sabbath was disturbed by Rome. Someone must understand that just because they might have close relationship to the life of him, it doesn't make them closer to the fullness of him, Emperor Haile Selassie, His Imperial Majesty. Some men believe that they are, because they are acquainted with the fullness and historical understanding whereby they are associated with the life and the liberty of him, they believe that they are closer to him than anyone else. Brethren, many there be that knew the life of the Christ Lamb of Jesus Christus, yet they abused his greatness. Yes. His cause was disrespected by the same Jews and elders of the synagogue who knew him. Therefore, it makes no difference. If one claims that they associate themselves with Haile Selassie, though they experience the liberty of him so closely, it doesn't make them closer to Rastafari than a man who live abroad. In fact, let us reason upon the fullness regarding such sabbatical understanding. Because on the Sabbath, wherein the blind man was healed, he was attacked by the Jews, and the Jews yelled at the blind man, saying, "You are the disciple, but we are Moses' disciple. We know that God spoke to Moses, but we don't know where this man came from." John 9:28 and 29, making reference, they're speaking of the Christ Lamb of Jesus Christus, making reference, putting down the blind man who gave praises to the Christ Lamb. That was a clear response to say that though the Jews knew about the life of the Christ Lamb, they did not accept the rebirth into his grace. But then, the Christ Lamb indicating that it's not so much fullness of physical knowledge of the Christly order, but a spiritual one. And this he says, as speaking from scriptural references, this is what he says: "For had he believed Moses, he would have believed me, for he wrote of me. But if he believed not his writings, how shall he believe my words?" John 5, 46 and 47. What more manifestation of spiritual discernment is there but the fullness of the Father Abraham showing his blessing to the Christ, as he, the Christ, speak on this wise, saying, "Your father Abraham was pleased to see that my days was coming. He saw it and was happy." John 8, 56. This clear scripture that even the father of the nation of Israel did not witness the birth and fullness of the Christ Lamb. But in truth, Abraham saw it spiritually. He did not have to be there physically. He did not witness the physical life, the physical birth of Jesus Christus. But how then, Abraham's true faith and greatness in connection with the spiritual realm of the Most High God, Xavier, do understand and analyze and accept and know it of the greatness of Jesus Christus? I speak likewise to him His Imperial Majesty. Many there with that claim that they know, that they understand, that they see, that they experience, that they know of the life of Him. They know not, they know not, they know not. Fire burn their soul. On this note, I want no man to come tell I in any competitive mood about the life of His Imperial Majesty, because I am connected to Him spiritually. Even if I was a mute, I would knowledgeable see and hear the fullness of Him. Not by letter, but by fullness of spiritual discernment. I know the spiritual fullness of His Imperial Majesty, as I know that His Imperial Majesty's spiritual essence is the essence of His grace, the Christ Lamb. But then, I must say that the spiritual life of Him is the spiritual essence of His grace. And in that note, it is our surety that Him, His Imperial Majesty Qedamawi, observed the first Sabbath, so said. This observance is not an act of physical motivation, but spiritual within thought and remembrance of that day. It was the fullness of pattern done by the Christ Lamb. Main reason, he was disrespected by the elders of the synagogues. His Grace Iiyesus, the Christ Lamb, left this Sabbath that was perfected in Him, pointing out that keeping the Sabbath of the seventh day is evidence not by work, but by faith and servitude in Him, not by letters of the old covenant, but without letters within as with the new covenant. Prophetically speaking, ye Exebia, Yalehunewini, Ulu Izati, Yakatilad, fire burn all that is called not of Jah. Fire burn all soothsayers of evil Mastema and Azazel, Exebia, Kuta Yenesi. Ethiopia's Sabbath was not perplexed by His Imperial Majesty. The changes shown was encouraged and instilled by the Romanian monster. At one point, it seemed that Ethiopia refusing to be battled by this negative impact of the European religious and political forces. The papal tyranny soon became a yoke so galling that Abyssinia determined to break it from their neck. After a terrible struggle, the Romanists were banished from their dominions and the ancient faith was restored. The church rejoiced in their freedom. This is an extract taken from the Great Controversy, whereby it reason and speak. But all said and done, the papal tyranny became such a yoke, such a garland upon the neck of the Abyssinians, that the Abyssinians decided to remove it from their neck, and in such doing, restored the ancient faith that was stored. And what was the anguish and the thought of this papal tyranny? Is it natural that the Romanist monsters, the bread of evil, they tried courageously and strengthened by the hands of liturgy, clergy, many of the orthodoxy, the faith of the orthodoxy, to bring about the changes of the first Sabbath, swapping it to Sunday Sabbath. Ethiopia has made its name in the past, one of which history stood out against religious and natural freedom of European domination. Writer Bekele He states, Ethiopian mystic transcend national boundaries. And a new word was coined. The word that was coined was in its fashion, named Ethiopianism. Code of independence, freedom from foreign domination or rule in political realm, self-determination in matter of religion. This is the fullness of Ethiopianism. A knowledge of a reasoning and understanding and thought can be taken from the book titled The Sabbath in Ethiopia, a book titled The Sabbath in Ethiopia, an exploration of Christian roots. That's the book of great knowledge. It is done by a writer. The writer named Bikeli Hay. And once and once, we'll get into the coverage and read the fullness of this book to speak greatly of the Ethiopian Sabbath. That was perplexed by the Romanian monsters. Who can contest the fact that it was the Israelite heritage as per pre-Christian Judaism that shaped the Ascomite culture? It's this same heritage that prepared the way for the acceptance of Christianity during the reign of Emperor Izana in 331 AD, when the consecrated fashion of Athanasius at Alexandria ordered Frumentius to be the first bishop of the Orthodox Church of Ethiopia. The writer Bikeli emphasized that the Ethiopians regarded themselves as the true Israel, chosen people of the Most High God Xavier. Wherein they were not emphatic as like unto whole Israel that had rejected Iesus Christus. Bikeli, the writer, pointed out that the similarity of their roots was unseen in their keeping of the Sabbath. He reasoned to the fact that the similarity of the root of the Ethiopian who established themselves as true Israel, their roots were so lightened, the similarity was there, as in contrast to ancient Israel. In it, the contrastment could point out that they keep the Sabbath, they did the dietary rules regarding eating clean and unclean foods, they circumcised on the eighth day. They kept the feast days and holidays as well, and a visual expression of the Ark of the Covenant, which magnified the tripartite division of the Most Holy and Holy and outer space of the sanctuary. There's no other established religion, including the Catholic, that has such display. So if one can understand how magnificent it is, and also the true fact is that Ethiopia transcends from boundaries to boundaries in terms of the sabbatical fullness of ancient order given to Judaism. Ethiopians must find back their roots and disembark from Rome and its custom. In centuries past, the isolation of African continent have played an integral part in the fullness of serving the Most High God, Xavier. Early Coptic Christianity of Syria and Egypt maintained ancient patterns of worship, practice, and theology that was not influenced by Hellenistic idea and the act of Western development via Burn Rome. We should know and accept the fact the ancient Ethiopia Christly fullness was molded and rooted with the acts of original Christly faith. With that, we all should know that the faith of the earlier fathers of Ethiopia was not known as Christianity. Many did not know that. Many accost the understanding, claiming that John Mark has bring through Christianity to Ethiopia. But my virgin, it is not so. At that time, Christianity was not a known fellowship as per the truth within the gospel nurtured by Peter. Christianity was originally founded only in Antioch, as it was first noted in the first century, but not an understanding of the era given by the ancient father John Mark. Both the Coptic and Ethiopian churches would have great influence in forming and inspiring many contemporary Sabbath-keeping independent churches of Africa. Beloved, Africa, as for the Coptic and Ethiopian Orthodoxy, was a central venue of the practicing and keeping of the Jewish Sabbath. But the plague of Rome intervened and dismantled the process of goodwill. One can see the understanding and also get enlightenment from the book called The Sabbath Roots, The African Connection, by Charles Bradford. I must underline and reason from the year 1530 to 31, Iman invaded Ethiopia with the idea to get the Christian Empire subject into Islam. Lebanus and Askum were burned to the ground during that conquest. In 1540, Emperor Galadowos succeeded his father, Emperor Libnadengel, and his appeal to Western Europe was on the basis to help against invading Muslims, because the Muslim was moving in. And Emperor Galadowos, seeking help, he appealed for Rome for help against invading Muslim. But then, Portuguese Viceroy of India dispatched an expedition to Ethiopia on the request of Emperor Galadowos. During the attack, leader of the Portuguese army, Estevão da Gama, was taken prisoner and was executed by the Muslims sometime in 1542. But months later, the combined forces of Ethiopia and the Portuguese army defeated the Muslims near Lake Tana, where Grand was killed in battle. Grand is the Muslim leader at the time. One can see the education given in the 16th century again, where it states that good relations between Ethiopia and Catholic Portugal happened due to want of aid against invading Islamic faith. Yes, the conquest of the Muslims bring about a diversion, which automatically give the Catholic good reason to send missionaries. And these missionaries on entering began to evangelize. And in evangelizing the Catholic faith in full letters, they did so. In 1554, Saint Ignatius De Loyola, who is a Spaniard, arrived in Ethiopia. And many theological discussions were set in place to reiterate the understanding of the natures of Christ and keeping the Sabbath, etc., etc. So, brethren, we understand again. Or Rome began to set themselves alight against truth. But many theological discussion begins, because the cup of Rome was not full. The heart again, the fullness and understanding again, the nature of Christ that Ethiopia counter kept, that Ethiopia Orthodox kept, was still not agreeable, not satisfactory by Rome. So they set a light to stamp on the residue of Ethiopia again with this fullness about the nature of Christ and keeping the Sabbath. Ignatius de Loyola was one of the main culprits forming the Jesuit Society, a society formed to enforce Catholicism on other nations, because Protestantism was on the rising and papal prestige was declining. The mission of the Jesuit in Ethiopia seek to enforce Ethiopian to relinquish their concept of worship and accept Roman authority and religious concept. Ethiopians were not stupid to disrespect the fullness of the covenant given as according to Judaism, which meaning the keeping of the Sabbath and the understanding of the fullness that they are given by their fathers. Ethiopia has kept their understanding up to date, and in that manner, they held on to their ancient practice of the first Sabbath and the knowledge of monophysitism, meaning one nature in Christ, of Christ, was continued. Emperor Galadius was smart enough to make sure that he overturned not the fullness then understood by the Ethiopian Council of Churches. Emperor Galadius was smart enough not to follow the concept of Rome and disregard the fullness of the Ethiopian Orthodoxy. But then, in the year 1603, as according to the Ethiopian history, missionaries including Pedro Pius arrived in Ethiopia again with intent to persuade the emperor to submit to the religion of Rome. In 1614, Catholicism had an influence on the Ethiopian emperor, and by 1622, theological discussions seemed to persuade Emperor Susenius I to adhere and accept the function and the fullness of Catholic principles and doctrines. And in such doing, he entertained the doctrine of Rome, which became the established religion of Ethiopia then, at that time. But the Ethiopian was making it certain that the Ethiopian emperor and the misinformed liturgy of the church that took side with the Emperor Susenius, Ethiopian made certain that it stayed within the fullness of the ancient doctrines. What did they do? Ethiopian people were firm in all the action done by Emperor Susenius. Are we about to roll? The final decision led to a massive 5-year war that resulted in the loss of millions of Ethiopian people, in which resulted in the emperor abdicating the throne, whereby his son, Phasaelidas, lifted to be the new emperor, restoring Ethiopian orthodoxy and the ancient creeds, the fathers of orthodoxy. In the year 1644, the Jesuit was expelled by Phasaelidas. Fire burn their soul. Xavier Kutayinesi. It's quite understandable that Emperor Susenius, pulling the fullness and act of woe, pulling the bread of poison into the Ethiopian Orthodoxy. But I speak again with assuredness that Ethiopian fight, where millions of lives were lost, millions of Ethiopian lives were lost because of their faith and their truth abide in the fullness of the first Sabbath. Prophetically speaking, for ready Babylon lai heyuni, ye Xebia Kuta, Abelone lai for ready Yafasisi. Ye Xebia Yalehuni wini uluizati ya katilali. Li huluni abaliti yet bareki senabati. Senebeti iluni lilja. Ilumi lija. Let judgment pronounce on Babylon. Let the wrath of God pour judgment on Babylon. Let fire burn all that is called out of Jah. Blessed Sabbath to all members. All praises to Jah. Man like Jonas Ife can continue to talk about this Sunday Sabbath was not on the part of Catholic or Catholicism, because I know for assuredly that so long we can see history as proof that the Babylonian and Catholicism system was already trying to infiltrate the fullness of Ethiopia and its long ancient way of serving Xebia. Fire burn their soul. Xebia Kuta Yenis. Fire burn Babylon. In fact, it's notable that during the era of His Imperial Majesty Qedamawi, the clergy, the liturgy, and members of the church were also involved exercising the act, encouraging and manipulating the king. an emperor then. Wherever Rastafari was as simple in everything that which was done, as he could be doublessly trying to hard to keep the peace of what was already done by his predecessor. There was great difficult cause, the banner of truth held by the Christian faith and Ethiopia. The Ethiopian battled for the existence of the seventh-day Sabbath. It was a wave of dark cloud that took many millions of Ethiopian life in the 16th and 17th centuries. The evil antagonistic mortar of evil, with the ambition to fit their kingdom in Xerxes, continued to attack the Ethiopian philosophical point of view regarding the first Sabbath observance. But then I speak in reverence and fullness of understanding, and here I say that though the world had views him to accept this Sunday Sabbath for a substitute of the first Sabbath, the defiance of the Ethiopians against Christendom and the authority of Catholicism paint a picture that the Pope of Rome and his Sabbath is a pillar for the dogs who among us murderers. Revelation 22 verse 14 speak of them that are outside the outer court. They are dogs, sorcerers, warmongers, and murderers, and biters. I may remind you that Rome insists to compel by force to make sure that the Ethiopians submit, swapping the first Sabbath to Sunday Sabbath. But the Ethiopians continue to prove to the hand of evil that they would rather obey the custom daring set by their forefathers of orthodoxy, or to die in the event for its purpose. Beloved, ones and ones, go tell Jonah C. Fay that he and his entourage can go to Mastema and the coast of Azazel and tell Lucifer that I said, Ye Xebia, Yalehuni Wini, Ulu Izati Yakatilas, for your burner is called a Dutch. No man can convince I, because I know that His Imperial Majesty observed the first Sabbath. Rastafari never swapped the first Sabbath for Lucifer's Sabbath. Fire burn, fire burn all evil. Blessed be HIM Qedamawi, Haile Selassie. Blessed be his name forevermore. Let the light of Jah so shine. Let's be Rastafari. I must say that it takes many moons considering the value of making this historical info. As Mr. JFA thinks I'm not of the blood of Ethiopia. But then, I await the hour, the manifestation of him, Shiloh, when he shall appear burning all that is not called. It's of interest to me in simplifying the arrangements done through him, Haile Selassie I, regarding this blessed day called Sabbath. It's all good reason that this blessed day of the week will forever be the day of greatness that was made by Xavier, father of us all. The day in question, which is the seventh day, the first Sabbath, is the known day reckoned as a sabbatical day governed and made by the everlasting Father, Xavier. And above it, there will be no other reason of truth. Sabbatical atrocities during the Dark Ages was a known thing against European countries that have no ties with Catholicism. There's a book named History of the Sabbath, published in 1862 by John Nevins Andrews. And it maintains an information wherein one of the topics of the book, chapter, title, The Sabbath During the Dark Ages, was edited as follows. We are now in search for the Sabbath among those who were never subjected to the Roman Pontiff. was a known thing that hymn writers of the centuries would sing to sleep into the history of the sabbatical fullness of Africa and the Abyssinians when depicting the fullness and understanding of the keeping of this holy sabbatical day, especially the understanding of the keeping of the Jewish customs done within Christianity. Yeah, writers like Bradford, Michael Geddes, Bekele Hay, John Nevin Andrews, Maury J. Talbert, and John Thornton, who took precedence from the traditional views of the sabbatical fullness shown within African point of views. These writers acknowledged the fact that the Abyssinia understand the truth within Christ and the fullness of the gospel that begins in the first century. The Act of the Apostles indicated that the Ethiopian eunuch received knowledge of Jesus preached by Philip, who was knowledgeable, taught by the apostles. One of the asks, why is it that the Church of the Abyssinians was not mentioned within the revelation given by to the Apostle John on the Isle of Patmos? But the answer is sure, that they were not listed as part of Christianity introduced by Antioch, and probably that they had no shortcoming within the divine worship of Christ, because all seven churches mentioned were of shortcoming. The writer Hemore J. Tobert, when speaking on the safe existence of the Ethiopian and their way of worship from the time of the ascension of the Roman bishop to the Pope's supremacy, he referred to Gibeon, who says, by enemies of their religion, the Ethiopians slept nearly 1,000 years, forgetful of the world by whom they were forgotten. The book, Gibeon, Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, chapter 47. However, it is well understood by the writer Imore J. Talbert, admitting that Ethiopia never slept in the way that Gideon stated. Ethiopia was simply out of Europe orbit at a time when Europe, not Ethiopia, was going through the Dark Ages. And while Ethiopia was influenced by the hero surrounding it, so was Europe. In fact, after Isaiah's acceptance of Christianity, Europe's knowledge, every reason on the part of the Ethiopian sabbatical worship was evident. As Jerome, who is a father of the Church of Rome, explained victoriously on the triumph of Christianity, we have stated that among the monks visiting Palestine daily, Ethiopians from time to time was also welcome. And this is the reason that since the Ethiopians were visiting Palestine during that time, daily, then of course, the fullness of the Ethiopian sabbatical worship was known by Rome. They are shown that Rome was well aware of the fullness regarding the Ethiopian gospel, and that Catholicism, triumph of Sunday worship, was never part of Ethiopian fullness during that era. During that era, Ethiopians were simply successful in maintaining the gospel, including the Jewish Sabbath, according to the scriptures of the OT. The writer Jane Anderson illustrated, referencing the same passage, making it clear that Ethiopians refused to accept practices and belief not biblical. The writer Andrews edited as follows. Transubstantiation and the adoration of the consecrated bread in the sacrament were what the Abyssinians. They deny purgatory. They know nothing of confirmation and extreme unction. They condemn graven image. They keep both Saturday and Sunday. Michael Geddes, Church History of Ethiopia, page 87 and 88. Ethiopians never conformed to what has no biblical understanding, and so it was never on the road to succumb wittingly to any form of Catholicism. The heart of Bekele did its preview of documentation, covering the keeping of the Sabbath from the time of the Apostle to the 20th century, where we found out that the Sabbath of Ethiopia highlights intense resistance during the 15th and 16th centuries. In this, we concluded that the outsiders, like Catholicism, used various strategies trying to change Ethiopian ways of worship, with an attempt to change the seventh-day Sabbath to the first day of the week, which is Sunday Sabbath. The Orthodox of the Ethiopian Church observed both Old Testament Jewish Sabbath and the Sabbath referred by Christian counterpart, most referred to the custom of Eastern and Western Christianity. In the era of times, because of the difference of the approach of keeping the Sabbath, we understand the history of the veneration of the Jewish Sabbath and its provocation of lasting controversy among the Ethiopian clergy. The monopoly of prophecy spoken of in the book of Revelation give evidence that locusts from the bottomless pit will seek out souls that have in the fullness of the living God, Xavier. At the command was listed not to overcome or hurt the grass of the herd. And the grass of the herd here refers to the chosen and blessed of the Most High God. The command was given that this monster and apostate leaders were to make exploitation, gaining victory over mankind, not of Jah. Whereas his conquest, that's the conquest of Mastema, and Azazel, and his entourage, from time to time, against mankind of this sort, should be for 5 months, which is 150 days. Prophetically speaking, this adds up to 150 years. Which according to the annalistic approach of the prophecy, beginning during the 4th century, when Imperial Rome becomes Papal Rome, about 383 AD. Many claim the turnover happened during the 6th century, but we see it the turning point when Emperor Gratian permits Pope Damasus as sovereign of the church and sovereign within the whole consecrated point of view in Roman apostasy as religion is concerned. In the year 383 AD, Pope Damasus became the first pope as the power of the Pontifex Maximus was handed to him. The Pontifex Maximus, meaning high priest, was the most important post held by the emperor in Roman religion. And this handover by Emperor Gratian was significant, and at a moment that the church began to wheel its smoke, selecting other popes and seeking souls for Azazel. So don't tell I that the Pope of Rome is not a bandit with the hands of Caesar. There must be, because as it is, Pope Gratian did hand it over the Pontifex Maximus, which is an independent of view, the power held by all emperor in Rome. The word pontifex and its derivative, that is pontiff, became a term used for Christian bishops, including the Bishop of Rome. And the title of Pontifex Maximus was applied to the Catholic Church for the Pope as its chief bishop. The official list of titles of the Pope given him, the Honoria Pontificio, includes Supreme Pontiff, which in Latin summons Pontifex, as the fourth title, the first being Bishop of Rome. We then see the changing of the strength occurs when the title Vicar of Christ, which in Latin means Vicarius Christi, appears in the 5th century in a synod of bishops, referred to Pope Gelasius I. This shows that the bottomless pit was open and the dark ages began, Revelation 9. However, the fullness of the prophecy continued in Revelation 13 and 17 in contrast to Daniel's prophecy, speaking of 1,206 years, with an extension of 1,290 days. Which also is 1,290 years. The policy is equivalent to the period from 508 AD, the time all European nations agreed to help the apostate work, assiduously evangelizing and devouring mankind that do not know the truth and do not know Jah. It was, of course, the tides of the prophecies that unfolds and waver the tales at the moment of the Holy Roman Empire that rises by the hate and hate of the Germania monster, the King of Franks and others. Revelation 9, 4-6 and chapter 13, 17. A man don't tell I that the Pope represent Christ, because if all Pope represent Christ, then the bondages of sin would not be removed from his place. I am a free man in Christ, but we are slave in sin with the Pope. For I have born Rome and all are joining confederates. Who says I am wrong, then tell I. Who encourages the slavery of I and I? Well, let's go back to the fullness of the sabbatical era in Ethiopia. The history unfolds that during the reign of King Zayakob, 1434 to 1468, observance of both Sabbath was officially accepted by the Ethiopian church and state. Though it can also be traced that the act of this worship could be found centuries ago within the borders of Africa. Let no man think that the Enoch of Candace brought this to Ethiopia, brought this under worship to Ethiopia, or that him, Haile Selassie I, had founded this act of worship, because it was inherited within the council he handles. In fact, going further, let me clear the air with John Mark, because the hand of evil is one. Because the hand of the evil one is desperate to mingle in the minds of babes in Christ, seeking to deceive the minds of all the lights. One must then understand that John Mark's visit to the land of the Coptic was evident and was within the time space of about 40-50 AD. Therewith, Christianity, as with the Gentiles, were never fully established in Antioch. World history of the 15th century indicated that Portugal had become particularly interested in developing trade with Ethiopia. Now this is history, which will unfold to explain the fullness and deceptive of Rome perplexing the Ethiopian and their Sabbath. World history of the 15th century indicated that Portugal had become particularly interested in developing trade with Ethiopia, which was initially a general in pretense. Portugal had become a world maritime power as its explorers and merchants developed a highly profitable trade across the Atlantic Ocean. Gold, silver, spices, and African slaves were their interests. Various popes had made this possible via Bon Pope, via Bon Vatican. Various Pope had made the slave trade possible. Pope Nicholas V in 1454 and Pope Callistus III in 1456 issued papal bulls going against the capturing of Christians and selling them as slaves. However, in the same papal bull, there was a recommendation of the capturing of Africans and the justification of African slavery by claiming that this would be an effective way of enforcing them to be Christians. Firebone Row, Zebia, Uta Yenis. Ironic it is that these people who claiming to be the apostles of light bring about a hand of evil, demoralizing the black and the African people, and in so doing, claiming to do good by evangelizing. But I say, where I burn their souls, judgment, I say. Nearly 40 years later, another pope broke the Treaty of Tardeselas, which gave Portugal monopoly over trade across the Atlantic from Africa to the Americas. The adjoining benefit was a route to China, but route to India were under the control of Islam. Therefore, Portugal needed an alliance with Christian Ethiopia to challenge Islam and establish trade route to India. During the next few years, Portuguese and Ethiopian monarchs sent emissaries back and forth to Portugal and Ethiopia. Blessed be the Most High God in Zebia. Blessed be his name forever. Sila. Let your eyes, let your enemies be scattered. Thank and praise his holy name. His name forever. Sila. Indeed, Ethiopia has its own problem with surrounding Muslim neighbors. And like Portugal, Ethiopia needed Christian but the European conflict only need to foster themselves a joint to the Ethiopians, thus by reason to evangelize Christianity of Western Rome. During the reign of Lebna Dingal, 1407-1440, the Pope of Rome then wanted to evangelize and spread the Catholic faith. In so doing, he appointed Don Francisco Alvarez, Giovanni Fernandez, and Pedro Alfonso Mendez. However, they were more successful with Lebna Dingal, Emperor Lebna Dingal, the young king of Ethiopia, because he spent many hours learning and listening about the Catholicism regarding Rome. King Lebna Dingal, who after being persuaded by the Pope missionaries and being overcome by the relentless attack of the Muslim state, was therefore forced to accept to recognize the Pope as Vicar of Christ. And so he issued an edict forbidding Sabbath observance. He became weak. He became troubled because of the continuous attack by the Muslim faith, and he needed their allies so as to be strengthened against the Muslim faith. In so doing, he bowed also. King Lebna Dingal bowed and accept and recognize the Pope as the Vicar of Christ. And in such doing, he issued an edict forbidding Sabbath observance. A copy of the letter to the Pope's Confederate States regarding to what King Lebna Dingal wrote, it reads as follows. We are willing to subject our faith and our church to the Holy See at Rome. We are willing to recognize the sovereignty of Portugal over our empire. We Ethiopia and the people of our empire are willing to become Portuguese and Roman Catholic subjects. To make this effective, we have given the bishopric to Bermandes, the Portuguese representative in Ethiopia. King Lebna Dingal, on the edict that he had sent, and the letter that he sent to the Pope, was well stating that he would give the Ethiopian people as states and citizens unto the Portugal, thus they becoming Portuguese and Roman subjects. So Lebna Dingal himself bowed. Emperor Lebna Dingal died in 1540 after he had issued that letter to the Pope, and his son Galadus succeeded the throne. King Galadus was also named King Claudius, who reigned from 1540 to 1559. He took stride to be victorious against the Muslim invaders. However, the young emperor rejected the claim. He removed the Portuguese clergyman Bermandes, who was appointed the bishopric to represent Ethiopia. Claudius also rejected Rome's authority over Ethiopia by using arguments taken from the book of the Catholic faith, where he disputed the claim that Ethiopia held allegiance to Rome. In the end, the emperor disavowed any allegiance to the Pope. He also issued a confession of faith supporting the celebration of Sabbath on Saturday. But then, King Galadus then become weak with continuous strife with the Pope of Rome and the Portuguese at him, and the continuous strife of the Muslim. He also become weak, regrettably so. Following the confession faith of King Claudius, his anxiety to retain the Muslim army at bay made him requesting help from the Pope and Portugal. He permitted by such request, he permitted a compromise plan which allowed Sunday worship alongside the first Sabbath worship. But during the course of time, Sunday Sabbath then received priority to the celebration of the two. The Chronicle of King Taglagordis I made effort describing this act of the era. Doubtless, the veneration of the Jewish Sabbath still being kept among the Christian in modern Ethiopia. It was not removed, it was not forgotten, it was still in existence. The rejection of the Ethiopian Orthodox clergy and the compromise idea of King Galadius, it resulted in a threat to excommunicate the emperor. But Galadius died in battle shortly, while the Pope and the Portuguese insist continually to force the observance of Sunday worshiping on the Ethiopians. Forcing Sunday worshiping was that they demanded that the observance of Sunday worship only exists, removing Saturday worship. Some emperors are more forthgoing than some, as some emperors think of other circumstances benefiting in the short term, rather than which benefiting religious spirituality, meaning some emperors believe that they would only think about the victory and the existence of Ethiopia in the sense of statesmanship and governance, but not on the matter of religion and spirituality. Emperor Minos, who ruled after Emperor Galadius, he take up the mantle, immediately banned the practicing of Catholicism in Ethiopia. While other emperors after him were more tolerant, according to the act of evil highlighting from Catholicism, they were more tolerant, accommodating the act of evil. Nevertheless, the opposed clergyman and the people of Ethiopia was firm on the decision of their faith, and so Catholicism and its way did not take hold. On the contrary, the edict of Emperor Galadius was strengthened by the late Emperor Zadignel. As Zadignel began to reign, he began to look the way of Rome. And with that, the Portuguese sent troops to ensure that his edict remained in force. Years of fighting followed on account of the enforced depression of Catholicism and the decision of Emperor Zadignel. A result of thousands of Ethiopians were killed by reason of maintaining the independence of Catholicism and the rule under the Pope of Rome. No man can tell I to be communication with the Pope, because I have no reason to. If you want I, tell him to come to I in reasoning. His Majesty do from time to time bid reason with many popes. But the judgment of the Trinity stands. And that tell I that my steam and the fortress of Azazel will fall. The guardian of the Trinity indicating scripture to you will remember all atrocities done by the hands of Lucifer. And on that day, all pouring of anguish will follow. But tell I, what if I ask you who blessed the Italian and the German sending them against the King of Kings of Ethiopia? And I will answer the I. It's the hand of the Pope and his blessing to see the fall of the Ethiopian from way back. To let Babylon fall, let judgment begin. Devia. For evidence of scriptures, in reason of the fullness of remembrance of evil and atrocities done by the wicked ones, Rastafari speak in great demand. And the word that follows in scripture that give evidence that the Most High God is able will not forget the atrocities done by Babylon. This is what scripture says, Revelation 18:4-6. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that they be not partakers of her sins, and that they receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities. Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her double according to her works. In the cup which she had filled, fill to her double. That's the fullness of evidence that the Most High God Xavier will not forget the atrocity done by Babylon and the evil land of Hazazel. But the powers remain. This I want no man to tell I to forget. Instead, let all children of Xavier step out of the seat of Babylon, lest you take part of her judgment. How can I forget the atrocities tied upon my people? How can I forget the enormous dead bodies laid upon the carpet of Ethiopia during the Italian invasion, especially the second, when such atrocities were encouraged by the Pope of Rome? Burn Babylon, I say. Xavier Kuta Yenis. Let fire burn their soul. The continuous attempt and forceful act of Catholicism also bridled another Ethiopian king, whose name was Susenius, ruling from 1607 to 1632. In the event, war broke out in Ethiopia regarding the existing question of the Sabbath, because the Pope of Rome was still hailing to be in control of sabbatical order. This king was clearly on the part of Rome and its Sunday worship. But the Ethiopian was still adamant not to be driven by the fantasy of Azazel. Emperor Susanius declared himself a Catholic in 1622. Thereafter issued a national decree abolishing the celebration of the first Sabbath, and thereon established Sunday worship in its place. Emperor Susanius bowed to Rome and its practice and disrespect the council of the heavenly fortress. The complete truth of the Ethiopian orthodoxy and its sabbatical fullness was endangered, but the people, being God-fearing, decided to die for the cause. And in this, a civil war broke out, lasting for about 8 years. The edict version of the writer, Emory J. Talbert, says that during the final year of his reign, Emperor Susanius fell ill and lost his ability to speak. His family apparently believed that he became mute because they had issued a proclamation against Sabbath keeping. Son of the Emperor sent letters to Ethiopia, religious leaders and noblemen requesting special prayer for his father. When Susanius recovered, he withdrew his ban on Sabbath keeping, proclaiming, we restore to you the faith of your fathers. Let the former clergy return to the churches. Let them put in their halters. Let them say their whole liturgy. Susanius himself realize in good fashion that it pays to stay speak to the fullness of the Most High God in Syria. And so he recalled his word and the judgment of the Most High God. But then Susanias died in 1632, and his son Facilidas take the throne. Facilidas, by hunting and executing the Jesuit representative, he worked endlessly, removing all forms of Catholicism from the Ethiopian borders. In all this, the Roman see was still adamant to convert Ethiopian to Catholicism by sending Catholic priests to Ethiopia. But then, Facilidas worked endlessly. Some were sought out and killed, entering the land. Some were stoned, while the rest went home on hearing the deeds done to their fellow men. And bring the news to their government, to the Pope of Rome, the Portugal, Inquisition, and speak of the great judgment that Facilidas, the Ethiopian emperor, has done. In 1648, the pastor beheaded two priests who announced that they had arrived from France. And for the time being, attempt to convert Ethiopia to Catholicism, and in the process to abolish the seven-day Sabbath, came to an end. But that was temporary. But however, that sounds like a blessing to me. We were true story hence well. However, this is not a story, beloved, or is it a tale, but a living historical fact. Regarding historical facts, some people claim that Sunday worship was not on the account of Rome, but I will reason with a few synopses of truth, and this is what I will say. The Sabbath in Ethiopian religious literature in the Geese language is commonly called SABBATH, which means the Jewish Sabbath. Qedamawi SABBATH, SABBATH Qedamawi is the reverse, meaning the first Sabbath. It even referred to as the near SABBATH, meaning the minor Sabbath. But so we understand then that the first Sabbath, SABBATH Qedamawi, was referred to as near SABBATH, the minor Sabbath. SABBATH HAHUD, the Jewish Sabbath itself, which is same as the first Sabbath, SABBATH Qedamawi, which should be the major Sabbath or the great Sabbath, is then referred to as the minor Sabbath. But then I understand the fullness given out thereon. But however, the confusion lies wherein if the Jewish Sabbath then was referred to as the minor Sabbath, then the great Sabbath should refer to the Sabbath given down by Jesus Christus the Christ Lamb, because he had perfected the minor Sabbath given down to the Jews, the Judaism, and he had perfected incense by governing on the way of his fullness. The Christ Lamb bring forth the SABBATH Qedamawi, the first Sabbath, that it should be governed not by ways of carnality, but by ways of spirituality, not by laws then, but by laws given to the powers of the Christ Lamb. We then understand then that the Sunday Sabbath in Geese language expression lies, as it says, SABBATH Christian, meaning the Christian Sabbath. It also been referred to as the SABBATH HAHUD, meaning the Sabbath of the first day, that is, the first day of the week. It's sometimes simply referred to as Ahud, Ehud, the first day, and also Habi SABBATH, the great Sabbath. Now we see that the Sunday Sabbath is now referred to as the great Sabbath. If it is referred to then as the great Sabbath, then it seems then that it has been perfected from the first Sabbath, becoming this Sabbath, the great Sabbath. But there's no perfection in this Sabbath, the great Sabbath, the Sunday Sabbath, because it has been kept also by even more law than the first Sabbath. So there's no greatness in its sight, there's no perfection in its sight. It's all been taken up in the fallacies of the Pope of Rome. In that we see that Sunday Sabbath was given priority over the two. It was still not that it was swapped by the church or the authority of Ethiopia. No swapping there. No swapping there by his Imperial Majesty. The seventh day of Jewish Sabbath, SABBATH OF ETHIOPIA, was still a priority, though lesser of the two. I still say no swapping there because by reason of truth and facts, and I state that as its perfection lies, the Most High God, Xavier, handed down to his Son, the Christ Lamb, Jesus Christus, and as he make it perfected in himself, that it has been given without law. And in that it has been given without law, it is as it is. Stand firm. And within its priority, it is in its priority as in perfection. But in the eyes of man, they see it without priority because it had no law. It is evident that Him, His Imperial Majesty, as for a unique and satisfying process, try to take issues and thought into consideration regarding this subject in Ethiopia. Him, His Imperial Majesty, gave it his best conclusion, whereas the anaphora of St. Athanasius was also used, putting all at rest. Him, His Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie I, respected the Sabbath of the seventh day. SABBATH OF ETHIOPIA is a Sabbath respected by him, Haile Selassie. SABBATH OF ETHIOPIA is a Sabbath respected by him, the Most High God, Xavier. It being in perfect to the Christ Lamb. And therefore, by reason of the act of His Imperial Majesty on the Sabbath day, it is full acknowledgement that Him, His Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie I, respected the Sabbath of the seventh day. SABBATH OF ETHIOPIA, the fullness of truth. But then as king, he is also attended Sunday service, a day that he inherited from his predecessors. It is no instead that up to 1960, one could see that the complete work prohibiting in Ethiopia Addis Ababa was not practiced. People would go to work and business upon their fullness, etc. While who wanted to attend church that day would seize the opportunity. That is the fullness and perfection given to the SABBATH OF ETHIOPIA in its perfection. Because by reason of the Christ Lamb, he added no law to the perfected SABBATH OF ETHIOPIA. SABBATH OF ETHIOPIA. I say tell that JFA, conveyor of error, to seek peace within himself first, and all will be revealed in the end. One must understand that the observance of both Sabbath on the same level was formally authorized in Ethiopia long before even the king, Tsar Yakov, 1434 to 1468, he reigned as king, a skilled theologian. He became as such in the course of the Ecclesiastic Council, which took place in 1450 at his newly built church of Dabra Mekmak, in the province of Shawa. His church regulation included the practice to celebrate two Sabbaths, and they are recorded in great detail in his treatise, especially the Book of Life. The Meshafe Berham. However, St. Eustathius, founder of this powerful movement called the Unpossessor, he inherited the observance and veneration of the Old Testament Jewish Sabbath from his spiritual predecessor. But the ecclesiastic and political arena persecuted the Eustathians before the reign of King Tsar Yakov. The doctrine of St. Eustathius then includes the equal veneration of both Sabbaths, which is Saturday and Sunday. history of Alexander Patriarch of Zarius Ibn Mukafi. Also give a light that the veneration was incorporated as far as to the 11th century. So we are understanding the fact and the movement thereon that the veneration of the first Sabbath, SABBATH, and the Sunday Sabbath was something being highlighted long before His Imperial Majesty Haile Selassie. Way back from the 11th century, way back even also from Tsar Yaakov. The history of the Alexander Patriarchs by Zawarus Ibn Makafu also give a light that the veneration was incorporated as far as toward the 11th century. It explained that the Egyptian bishop Severus, who became Metropolitan of Ethiopia, requested Coptic Patriarch Cyril II, who reigned in the 11th century, he asked him to help him to stop the observation of Judaic rites in Christian Ethiopia, meaning that he's stepping on the toll of Judaism. He's stepping on the worshipping and service of the Jews. The twist was obvious because Bishop Severus probably was totally in feud with the Jews, and yes, he was. So the idea of this restricted act against the Jewish Sabbath was sailing as far as from the 11th century. Again, between the 12th and the 13th century, we see it. Let me repeat. Again, between the 12th and 13th century, we see it pulse up again, where we see King Lalabella inscription carved on a wooden altar. The inscription carved on a Manbara tabot. It's a wooden altar, but in the Geese form, it's Manbara tabot. And the inscription saying the word Sanbatian, meaning two Sabbaths. This inscription also implies that during the reign of King Lalabella, the veneration of two Sabbaths, Saturday and Sunday, was also in existence. During the reign of King Tsar Yaakov, observing both Sabbaths was natural. But one cannot say whether both Sabbaths had the same status among Christians in the Horn of Africa at that time. However, in the 16th century, the Portuguese arrived in Ethiopia and created a wave of turmoil regarding Jewish Sabbath. The Portuguese came with strict orders to dismantle and remove from the plate of Ethiopia the observance of the Jewish Sabbath. The Portuguese were sent by the Pope of Rome to enforce Sunday Sabbath, whether by goodwill or by force. According to the Pope, it was imminent. King Galadus, also known as King Claudius, announced treatise, his Confession of Claudia, which emphasized that the Ethiopian Christians must celebrate Saturday, that the veneration of Sunday in commemoration of the resurrection is much more than that of Saturday Sabbath, First Sabbath, SABBATH OF ETHIOPIA. However, it is known that the Ethiopian rejected King Claudius' request of the celebration of the Sunday Sabbath above the Saturday Sabbath, First Sabbath. Some scholars take it to the understanding that the changeover and Sunday Sabbath priority was not proven biblically, but a reference given under disguise by the Portuguese and the European endeavors, where the matter was underground taught by Catholic fathers and the Pope of Rome, seeing that the Lord was risen on a Sunday. But in fact, I for one disapprove the saying that the Lord's day was on a Sunday, but on the closing of the Sabbath on the seventh day. It's obvious and the protocol follows in biblical references. It is clear in chapters. One chapter speaks on this light, as it says, going toward the first day of the week, when the beloved reached the tomb, the Christ Lamb was already risen. Going toward the first day of the week, men, that upon the moment that they went there, he was already gone. Then how can you say that he was risen upon that specific time or day? When you went there that day, he was already gone. In hindsight, that's nonsensical. Another verse, chapter speak on this wise, and it says that dawn, when the beloved reached the tomb, the sepulchre, the Messiah was already risen. And I speak again in the same reference. If at dawn that you reach the tomb and the Messiah was already risen, how can you say then at dawn he was risen? Nonsensical in the depict of man of truth. Fallacies upon the tongue of evil. Another excuse points to the fact that the Jewish Sabbath in many cases cannot be observed because in the case of war, they would be trodden underfoot by the attackers in the keeping of the Sabbath. But how say this then? When the king and emperor Menelik II fought under this jurisdiction and encamped with victory, it seemed a surmount of fallacies and the derivative from ignorant understanding by whom desires removing the specification of that the first Sabbath requires. Fireborn Babylon, fireborn Rome, and the act of evil of Azazel and Mastema. In the 18th century, we see in some instances that both Sabbaths were celebrated as a rest day. For example, this takes place during one of the military campaigns by Takla Haymanot II. I bring to mind the reason of such and put into you the fullness that in all jurisdiction and fundamental aspect, that the observance of both Sabbath was a follow-up from way back as of the 11th century. The fullness of this was not edifying in any context to say that his Emperor Haile Selassie was the one who bring forward the fullness. Because in the history of the Chronicles, we can see that the veneration of both Sabbath exists years before His Majesty had manifested himself as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The Chronicles, during the time of Takla Haymanot, it narrates and say as follows, and they stayed at Hankasha and took rest during 3 days in order to pay honor to both Sabbaths. Paying honor to both Sabbaths, meaning that in Takla Haymanot, the second his reign, both Sabbaths didn't exist. That was in the 1870, because this man reigned 1769 to 1777. We see again another approach where the observance of Old Testament Sabbath was demonstrated by King Takla Gorgias I. He did reign for a sixth time at the end of the 18th century AD. And in his military expedition of early 1781 in the north capital of Gondar, against a rebellious landlord called Gadlu, he at least twice neglected to halt on the Old Testament Saturday. Otherwise, at the same time, the celebration of Sunday remained rather strict. So therefore, we understand that King Takla Gorgias I, he was more in representative of the Sunday Sabbath. And it was so that even upon the day when the warriors went to war, King Takla's became hungry. And he speak and said, everyone who fight today is not my subject, since Sunday is not a day of fight and war, but a day of rest and prayer. It showed that the priority was given to Sunday over Saturday by King Takla. I'll be hit in exceptional situation though. It reflects the genuine Christian nature of the observance of the two Sabbaths in Ethiopia. It shows that Ethiopians that never disregard or remove the first Sabbath, SABBATH, ahold for the Sunday Sabbath, SABBATH Christiani. Rastafari himself, HIM Qedamawi, had nothing to do with the changes, but an inherited move done by his predecessor. Howbeit, he could have it returned to its original keeping, but with the endorsement of peace, the changes was imminent. There's no proof in scriptures that the changeover was biblical on the part of the apostle of Christ or the Christ Lamb. But it was a Romanian thing to disperse the body of oneness between Jews, Gentiles, and Romans, Christians. It's of no evidence that the Christ Lamb had or had it in mind to change this function of the sabbatical expression of the seventh day that was created by Xavier, father of the Christ Lamb and father of Christ King. This day is a permanent setting that will establish throughout life itself as a day-to-day living in Zion, as all day will be a Sabbath. This expression is noted in the Genesis of the Millennium, spoken of in the book of Revelation 20, that speaks of the rest with Xavier. In Hebrews 4 saying, "For we which have believed do enter into rest, as he said, as I have sown in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the work were finished from the foundation of the world." For he speaks in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise, "And God rested the seventh day from all his work. For if Joshua had given them rest, then would he not afterwards spoken of another day? There remained therefore a rest to the people of the Most High God." End of quote. It is natural to understand the fullness thereof, because it speaks not definite of a day as day of the week of another day, but it speaks of another era, another time, another moment, when the rest will be given unto the people of Israel. In misunderstanding the concept given, the Pope of Rome speaks on this wise, that it speaks of a heyday. The rest is not another day as in day of the week, but a day that is 1,000 years with him, the father of Xavier. Babylon has no understanding within Jah's fullness, but nevertheless, all was at will, but not all was made known until the appointed time. As for the words of the prophet Daniel that says, "But thou, O Daniel, shut up the word and seal the book, even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased." Daniel 12, verse 4. Xavier is all glorious. He will what he will. However, one must take in consideration why the Christ Lamb expresses the day by saying, "But pray ye that your flight be not in winter nor on the Sabbath day." Then it's a known thing that the Christ Lamb speaks specifically of the era of the end of days, and with it he made reference to the seventh day Sabbath. And such he make mention, he speak that even upon the last day of judgment, the day of turmoil, the SABBATH ahold will still be in existence. So even the Christ Lamb in his message to all stated that the first Sabbath will still be in function even on that day. In all this, we understand that the logical period of time to examine this change in observance is in the 2nd and 3rd century. The writer who has been most influential in arguing that the change of the day of worship is to be traced to this time period is Samuel Bakioki. Samuel Bakioki's theories indicate that 2nd century Christians at Rome adopted Sunday worship to distinguish themselves from Jews. Bakioki argues that the shift of the day of worship from Sabbath to Sunday is the end product of a prolonged process that took place after the New Testament period, and that Christians at Rome contribute to this process at several crucial times. Fire burn row. Xavier Kuta Yenesi. Bakyaki's thesis speak of a strong anti-Judaic political and social climate at Rome, with the fact that the Christian community at Rome was likely to be largely Gentiles in its makeup. And that's a fact. Because at Rome they are more likely to be Gentiles. And so forth. The fullness of the issues that have been taken between the apostles and the followers were on the account of the Jewish jurisdiction within the laws of keeping the commandment, the Sabbath, and the function therein regarding the fundamental aspect of laws within the Jews. And that's why it became a rift between the Pauline doctrine. And so it said, so done. Peter take the toll, speak unto the Jews, while Paul moved the Pauline doctrine to the Gentiles. And a separation of service and of truth become in details. Where Gentiles think to themselves to separate themselves from the sabbatical order of the Jewish function, began to create for themselves a day of worship. The Gentiles in Rome combined to create a climate in which Roman Christians differentiate themselves from Jews by de-emphasizing the Jewish day of worship, the first Sabbath, and emphasizing instead Sunday as a day of worship. Fire burn Babylon, fire burn Rome. As evidence for the larger Gentiles' character of Rome, Bakyaki cites the report of the historian Suetonius, saying that Emperor Claudius expelled all Jews from Rome. This was but one several move against the Jews that took place under different emperors, including the imposition of large taxation, which includes the so-called temple tax. Thus, Gentiles Christians at Rome would have every incentive to distinguish themselves as much as they could from Jews. One way they could do so is to worship on a day other than the Sabbath day. Because in their hindsight, they claim that they have nothing to do with the Jews. And yet still they accept the order and the fullness and the sanction given down by understanding of a Jewish religion. Bakyaki finds evidence that they, in fact, chose to do this in the following two historical notes that came from the mid-5th century, which is approximately a century after the time of Constantine the Great. In his ecclesiastical history, 719, the historian Suzomen says, "The people of Constantinople and almost everywhere assembled together on the Sabbath, as well as on the first day of the week, which custom is never observed at Rome or at Alexander." It's natural that we understand the fundamental and the argument laid down by Suzomen. What he's saying, in the East, in Alexandria, Constantinople, there was the fullness of both Sabbaths in veneration. But in Rome owned the worship on Sundays. One might compare the comment of another historian of the church, Socrates Scholasticus. In his ecclesiastical history, 522, read as follows. "Almost all churches throughout the world celebrate sacred mysteries of the Sabbath of every week. Yet the Christian at Alexandria and the world celebrate sacred mystery of the Sabbath. Yet the Christian at Alexandria and at Rome, on account of some ancient tradition, do not do this." Bakyaki knows that the earliest surviving evidence of Sunday worship is associated with either Rome or Alexandria, and it dates to the 2nd or 3rd centuries. Prominent among these writings are the Epistle of Barnabas, the writing of Justin Martyr, Barnabas, as who done him work, which he did, is usually said to have its origin in Alexandria in the early 2nd century. Chapter 15 of this work deals with the Sabbath. In the work, his word Sabbath points not to itself, but to the 8th day, the day of resurrection. Now tell me, you have 8 day in a week. I have not seen 8 day in a week up until this very day. I still seen 7 days. So how could Sunday be an 8 day? Ironic it is and nonsensical on the term of this fullness. The present Sabbath are not acceptable to me, but that which I have made, in which I will give rest to all things and make the beginning of the 8th day. That is the beginning of another world. That is the reasoning of Barnabas in the epistle of Barnabas, a father of the Catholic Church. So what is it saying then? It's obvious then that they have created this day. The day was not given by the Most High God, Xavier. Neither was it perfected through his son, the Christ Lamb, but was given to them the Pope of Rome, entourage of Hazazel, an instrument of Mastema, who are from the fountain of Lucifer, for you burn their soul. That is the beginning of another world, you refer to it? Wherefore, we also celebrate with gladness the 8th day in which Jesus also rose from the dead and was made manifest and ascended to heaven. No, I can't understand this. How could the Most High God let his son, the Christ Lamb, rose on a day that never exists? The 8th day, we still live in a week that has 7 days, yet the Most High God allow his son to be risen on a 8th day. Nonsensical under the part of Rome. Almost all commentators would agree with Bakayoko because they are nonsensical and have no fullness of the inspiration of the Most High God, Xavier. They reasoned on the paramount and promoted regarding the day, speaking that the Lord was resurrected according to Barnabas on a Sunday. But where is the evidence? Because scripture in detail speaks of it naturally. It didn't say that the man was risen upon the Sunday. It said going towards the Sunday night. Because in evidence, in Jewish catalog, the night comes before the day. So just as the Sabbath ended, you have Sunday night. And if it was that the beloved went to the tomb Sunday night after Sabbath Eve, and the Most High God, Xavier's son, was not there, how can you say the Christ Lamb was risen on a Sunday when he was already risen when you went there the Sunday? Fallacies and errors of evil. Many would also add that this was the first in mention as of Sunday observance, and that was by reason, or one of the reasons, that they perpetuate the day given as Sunday Sabbath, for you burn their soul. The Roman martyr Justin wrote his first apology in the reign of Antoninus Pius in the 2nd century. And this work can be dated firmly in the middle of the 2nd century. In chapter 67 of the first apology of Justin, he described the weekly Christian worship in the following terms. He said, "And on the day called Sunday, all who live in cities or in countries gather together to one place, and the memorials of the apostle or the writings of the prophet are read as long as time permits. Then when the reader has seized the present verbal instruction and exhort to the imitation of these good times, then we all arise together and pray, and as we before said, when our prayer is ended, bread and wine and water are brought, and the present in like manner offer prayers and thanksgiving." The president in like manner offer prayers and thanksgiving according to his ability, and the people assent, say amen. Here then is also in regard, it's a clear description of a weekly meeting that took place on a Sunday, that also has the trappings one might expect of a worship service on a Sunday in the second century. The reading of scriptures and homily and the giving of bread and wine was also part of the daily service that bring forth. So what then? It is clear to understand that by the middle of the second century, Christians in Rome were clearly meeting on Sunday for worship experience they were having. No mention is made of any such meeting on Sabbath. So it's clear to understand that in the peak of the second century, Rome itself fasted Sunday worship and removed by inauguration and the fullness of their own guile the Sabbath worship. Thus, by this time at least, in Rome, the change of the day of worship appears to have taken place. In the same passage, Justin gives the following reason for a meeting on Sunday. This is what he says. Because it is the first day on which God, having wrought a change in the darkness and matter, made the world. Jesus Christ, our Savior, on the same day rose from the dead. From these and other strands of evidence, Bacchiocchi concludes, the traditional claim that the Church of Rome has been primarily responsible for the institution of Sunday observance. Though widely challenged by recent Catholic and Protestant scholars, has been amply substantiated by our present investigation. Bacchiocchi thus traced the change of the day of worship to Rome in the second century, or perhaps even earlier. He hypothesis that the principal reason for the change of the day of worship is that the predominantly Gentile Christian community at Rome was at pain to distinguish itself from Jews in its religious practice, meaning they don't want to be collaborate or to be mentioned among the Jews. Thus they exclude worship on Sabbath and instead emphasize worshiping on Sunday. Constantine, knowing the coming shortly after, endorsing and made it a more prominent across the globe of Western and Eastern churches. But then I put it to all Rastafari members, even I must say that Christ was not risen on Sunday, which was the mere excuse used by many. Without a doubt, the Christ Lamb was risen on the sundown of the Jewish Sabbath. In fact, all scripture leads to such analytical point of view. Beloved ones and ones, please to be acceptable with the love of Him, His Imperial Majesty, as He was not the hand of predicament, but it was an inheritance fostered within the fold that He inherited. It is now our duty as sons and daughters of Qedamawi to set things right, as the fullness of the scripture says, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect, Matthew 24:24. Him, Qedamawi, was not fooled, as he never swapped this day for the first day, but allow whomsoever to fulfill the course of peace that was set before him. For I, every day is a Sabbath, but I endorse and uplift first and foremost the day given by the Father for us all. Him, His Imperial Majesty, accept it as well, seeing that he goes to church on a Jewish Sabbath. Let his name be praised. He's a good shepherd. He reads to Tihuru, he ran in Nui. Ezebia, Yemisken. Sila, let's be thy name forever. Let's be thy name. Amen. Bless be all sons and daughters of my Father. Bless be all children of Rastafari. Bless them that bless themselves in Haile Selassie. Blessed be them, the sons and daughters. Healers of Qedamawi. Ezebia Kuta Yinis. Ezebia kuta benolani life ordine ya fasisi. Iwizu hi hexebia bege nui. Muambisa zi imnegedi ke yuda. Rastofara hi hexebia bege molati nui. Kile mawe silasi tiru melkami irene nut nachui. Kile mawe ale silasi. Of course he's a good shepherd. Iwizu hi he yuda hannibasi nui. And of course he's a lion of Judah. Misgani hihun lihab lihud le memphis kedus sarim. Lewotrim lezili lahimu. Glory to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Lumi hi Christosi, avaliti selami haile selasi Qedamawi. Blessed be the name of Most High God, Ezekiel. Zibat lihub, behold, memphis kedus, lialem, lialem, lem. Already Babylon lai yehuni, the wrath of Jah, go down in Babylon. Be his name forevermore.